Sometimes you don't think about the life we live as a blessing, as an opportunity, as God's grace, as God's favor. At times we focus on what we think is not working, what we think we don't have, what we think we'll have. But we don't forget, we do forget what we have. While we are to see His gracious blessedness, His love, His faithfulness. I pray for you in the name of Jesus that you don't live in the state of asking and asking and asking and asking. Rather, you live in a state of thanksgiving, seeing around you, looking around you, perceiving things which are going on in your life. May you see what God has done in your life. May you be able to see what you have provided to you by God, and testify of His faithfulness in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. Brothers and sisters, His faithfulness is consistent and is eternal. And then that is why I say it's always beautiful to see what God sees. You know what God knows has done in your life. He knows He's done a lot in your life. In fact, everything. But I can live a life whereby I don't see that which has been done. I can live a life of blinded life, whereby I don't see that which God has done. But it's a blessing to know and see that which God has done in your life. Look at what you have. Look at where you are. Look at you. Your entire being, your entire makeup, everything about you. We've got reasons and reasons to thank Him and be thankful and grateful. And that is the key to continually walking in victory. Deep calls upon deep. Imagine thanksgiving calls upon thanksgiving. That's how it works. He says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, there's a portion of the scripture we're reading and studying. He says, when anyone is united to Christ, there is a new world. The old order has gone, he says, and a new order has already begun. This kind of message is a statement of fact. It is not a promise. It wasn't something that was about to happen. It was eye-opening. It was to present to the people who are listening to Paul that, you know what? The new has already begun. It is not going to happen. It is not going to begin. It has begun. You might not have seen it, but it has begun. The new has begun because the old has gone. This is logic. Simple, it's logical, you can get it. The old life has gone, the new has begun. So there is a new life which has begun. And I want to ask a question. When did this new life begin? When did it begin? It began when the old had gone. And when did the old go? On the cross, Jesus is crying out that it is finished. On the cross, Jesus is giving out, is stating something very profound. He says, it is finished. Tetelestai, meaning it is fully paid. So the payment of any debt, any requirement was made. There's nothing like I have to pay this or I have to pay that. Rather now, we have to fully acknowledge the free life, the new life, the life of freedom. But this kind of freedom is not what people know about freedom. I'm talking about what the Bible calls the liberty of the sons of God. So there's such a thing as the liberty, the freedom of the sons of God. See, freedom in the eyes of men and freedom in the eyes of God is different. What people know about freedom to their in their minds is to do what they want. But if that is what they call freedom, they have to think of this. Is it true that really, really men do what they want? You see, when men are slaves under a certain law, the law of sin and death, they might be deceived that they are actually free. We are not free until we realize that the law of spirit and of death, of the law of death, the spirit of death and sin worked and was operative in every man prior to Christ. That no man out of Christ or the one, or if he has never come to and know what Jesus Christ has done for humanity, no man can walk in freedom, total freedom, the full meaning of what freedom is like, because we're talking about the present, the past, and the future, the freedom that God had in mind, and that is the true freedom. So people walk in slavery, but they interpret it to be, you know, free. For example, in the Old Testament, when you see how the children of Israel who left Egypt to Canaan in the wilderness, on their way to Canaan in the wilderness, they began to murmur and they were complaining about the life they were living in and saying that they were better off in Egypt. But anyone who's not biased, who was to analyze and look into this matter, you would find that this is too much. How could you say that? How could you say that in Egypt you were better off, yet they were always under scrutiny of the Pharaoh who didn't know Joseph? A different Pharaoh who didn't know what Joseph did for the country, and he put all the Jews into slavery. These people were slaves. But can you imagine someone who's out of slavery claiming that when he was under slavery, he was better off? So these are the thoughts and ideas of deception. You cannot believe that the person will say that if you are neutral or you are trying to understand what was going on. Unfortunately, many people followed those ideas. They just believed that, yes, when they were in Egypt, they were actually doing well and they are dying in the wilderness. And the whole atmosphere of the wilderness to them was different. There was this pillar of cloud in the night. It was becoming fire. They had this protection. They lacked nothing. Food was always on their table. Every morning there was food. There was nothing lacking. But you see, when someone complains, doesn't necessarily mean that he's right in his complaints. At times, he closes his eyes to what he has to begin to find reasons that are not adding up. So this is exactly what I'm talking about. People don't interpret well the word freedom. Freedom has been abused as well. So the freedom we are talking about, that we find in Christ Jesus, it is a freedom of first and foremost to be free from the law of sin and death. The law of sin and death. And when we are free from the law of sin and death, what happens to us? We fall into the law of the spirit of life. Oh, glory to God. So if you are then to again bring or give your your verdict or conclusion on this, you will say that the true freedom is when you are aware of your move from the old life to the new life, and the scope, the extent of the kindness, the goodness, the grace in that new world, new city, new place where you are in Christ. So the freedom is when you are not under the law of sin and death. And yet the Bible tells us that, of course, people used to be under the law of sin and death. In Adam, that's what works, that's what happens. So you cannot walk in freedom in Adam, but you can walk in freedom in Christ. So walking in Christ is different from walking in Adam. And then what people think about freedom when they are under Adam, when they are in Adam, is different from freedom when you are in Christ. When you are in Adam, you think you are free, that you want to do what you want to do. But everything people do without the light of Christ is only harming themselves, is only self-destruction. So what kind of freedom that eventually produces destruction? What kind of freedom is that which produces destruction, which destroys someone's life? And you call it freedom? What is freedom when someone is killing himself, is dying, is ignorant, it is impossible? Because freedom walks hand in hand with responsibility. Have you realized that when you grow up, you begin to take responsibilities, and those responsibilities are based on your understanding, your knowledge? So once we come in Christ, there's a new light, a different light. So we have a different kind of understanding of what freedom is. And we realize that in Adam, you can never be free because you are blinded, and whatever you're doing seems to be right, yet it is self-destruction. So once we are free from self-destruction, then we know better. We know better in Christ Jesus. So he said, when anyone is united to Christ, there is a new world. The old order has gone and a new order has already begun. So there's a new order, a new life of freedom. Freedom in Christ. Freedom because we are seeing now. Freedom because before we used to be blind, but now we can see. That is the freedom of perceiving what God is perceiving, seeing what God is seeing, the peace in Christ, the life in Christ, the victory in Him, the love of God, understanding life in the right perspective. That is the new freedom, because we shift from darkness to light. That's the way we find freedom. Thank God for the new life that has already begun. It began when the old passed away. The new world has begun. The new life has begun. It is present and available today for you and I. Shalom, shalom.